Welcome, everybody. Thank you very, very much for joining both Jen and I on this fourth webinar of a series of webinars that's dedicated to this mandible and mandibular complex. I've been looking forward to this webinar for many years, actually. And the title of it is Occular Dysfunctional, Movement Association with Mandibular Temporal Function. It's a mouthful. I hope you're patient because it's probably going to take a little more than an hour and 40 minutes. I hope not to go over 2 hours. But I hide slides, and I've hidden slides in the past a little bit to get through the material. But this one, Jen, we didn't hide any slides. So I want to try to get through most of the material the best way we can. And I won't be able to accept any questions. If you know me, I love questions. But what's that, Jen?
We'll do a few questions at the end.
Okay. But anyway, so I always want to stay focused on the timeline we have that, you know, we're permitted to do this in. So as we learned in the last webinar, for those of you who are here or listen to it, in the series on mandibular function, the human visual system significantly influences and is influenced by the motor and neurologic processing of mandibular expression and resting position. And I feel very strongly that we all know that there probably isn't a more significant bone on our body for that reason, for expression, for rest, for processing of our neurological input, and for the output that we actually can give both to others and to ourselves by the use of our mandible. In this presentation, I'll try very hard to outline how our visual processing of the orientation of ourselves and the surrounding space that we live in can impact the position we develop our facial and our oral patterned function, especially over a course of time. The position of the head is primarily cognitively recognized by its location on our cervical spine. And when I say cervical spine, I'm really referring to the entire spine, but we rest on that atlas of that cervical spine, its contact point. The interconnections between the head or the visual system, the mandible or the stomatognathic system, and the neck or the autonomic system is the superior colliculus of the brain. So there's this part of our brain, this area called the colliculus area of our brain. They have an inferior and superior aspect of it. When you say the word head, mandible, and neck, the interface of that circuitry really begins and kind of ends and is ongoing in that area of the midbrain called the colliculus region. This structure coordinates visual, somatic, auditory information by directing the movement of the head and the eyes towards the source of the stimulus. So as soon as I hear Jen talk, I turn to look at her, because that process that I just heard, that the otic center that I have, the hearing that I have, the communication that I wish with her requires my colliculus to allow me to integrate that circuitry to make my head allow my neck to rotate it, the head, to Jen. It's a really wonderful region of our body when it comes to gesturing, when it comes to breathing, and when it comes to coordinated activity with all of our extremities. The structure coordinates, I think I said that. It is a paired structure in the lower midbrain that is involved in incorporating environmental stimuli and coordinating gaze shifts involving both eye and head mandibular movement. So when I say the word shift, you know, you have to think about the colliculus. It's the region of our body that says its number one purpose is to make sure that you have paired bilateral shifting with stimuli that it's receiving and with stimuli that's got to be processed. Now, in the beginning of this webinar, I'm going to speak a little bit more to the aspects of neurology. I think this is an area that really needs to be broken down a little bit neurologically so we can have a better understanding of the physical componentry that's behind the operation of what you do with your eyes when you turn them, and what you do with your mandible when you turn it. And again, in this discussion, please remember that you have two of each. You have two eyeballs, you have two orbits, you have two fossas, and you have two globes in those fossas. They're called condylar heads. And kind of keep that in mind. Fusion is a big word for the symphysis of your mandible. Fusion is a big word for the symphysis of your two eyes. Your optic center, your otic center, your occlusal center all understands that fusion. There's two sides of that activity. And the process that goes on to process that bilateral activity starts and ends with this collocular area. Vision plays an important and direct specific role in the control of mandibular placement and postural reactions to this placement via the vestibular nuclei. For those of us who have the ability to see with our eyes, to actually process what we see with our eyes, our visual mandibular function directs and controls our postural activity of the muscles of the lower limbs to enable us to do that. I feel so strong about this topic that I just left that I felt it, I felt it was a requirement for me to type up a summary that summarizes this research that was done by Valentino. And you have, Jen, I believe you have that white paper that I typed up in the back of your
One of the handouts that's posted on the webinars page. So it's a separate handout.
I took the liberty of typing up what this research that I'm referring to by the slide says. You know, it illustrates the functional relationship between three muscles of the leg before the artificial creation of interdental malocclusion exists. It's an article that tells you that the neurology between muscles that you chew, talk, and swallow with are directly and indirectly connected, I'll use that word very loosely, to the muscles of your leg. Your leg knows what your mandible is doing, and the mandible knows what the legs are doing, is what I'm trying to get across. And you can read about it. These are bundles of fibers in the vestibular region. And I think it's important for anybody out there doing any type of movement processing to know that your legs do not work in a vacuum. Your legs are totally responding to where is the center of your neck. And what the center of the neck revolves around is this ability to understand this bulbar vestibular nuclei that is constantly getting information from your visual and your auditory system. So functional relationships between the muscles of the mastication and the muscles of the lower leg is outlined in a handout somewhere in your manual. I think it's in the back. And again, it's one of my favorite reads. Why am I talking about legs and mandibles? Or why is that important? Because the same process that's going on with the legs goes on with your arms. And the same process that's going on with the arms and legs is going on with two ramuses of your mouth. So your mandible has functional purposes that are all connected to the other two appendage sets. And it's all done through a visual cortex. It's a visual cortex function is definitely involved in the integration of those three pairs of appendicular structures. The neurology associated with vestibular stability and balance in the position of both the temporal bones with respect to the mandibular heads have a major influence on the ocular and mandibular dysfunctional movement that you so often see in the clinic. This webinar does not take, I'm not gonna take in consideration because I only have an hour or two, of those experiencing issues with displacement of the temporal mandibular disc on one or both sides of the face. The temporal mandibular joint disc disorders often exist in patients with strabismus, a condition where the two eyes are not working well together. Temporal mandibular dysfunction, eye strain, and neck or head malalignment often coincide with that issue. And I'm going to talk about this later in this webinar and get more specific to what kinds of eye function and dysfunction do you see with joint issues of the mandible. So for those of you in the room that are not in the healthcare industry. You have a disc that lays between this condylar head and this thing called an eyeball. It's really not an eyeball. It's a temporal joint. It's a fossa. It's an opening. It's a cave. And between that surface of the temporal bone and the surface of the condylar head, you have a little disc, you have this little globe that's being moved around by movement of the temporal bone, and movement of the mandible. It's seated in this intermediate range, what some dentists would call in the stomonathic system, a centric orientation. It's sitting there, and when the jaw moves or the temporal bones move, when you chew or talk, or you sleep and you clench, whatever you might be doing with pressure gradients that either are being compressed or reduced through some type of relaxation effort or movement on the other side, that disc will move around. It's very mobile. When you open your jaw, the disc moves forward. When the head of the condyle is displaced behind that disc, we call that an anterior disc displacement syndrome. And I'm only talking about it because we have eyes that are displaced. We have feet that are displaced, and we have hips that become displaced. For us to think that this displacement, all type of displacement, only exists in a joint called the temporal mandibular region is a misnomer. We have displacements all over our body where one compressive force is too high and one uncompressive force may be too low. So keep that in mind as we go through these next few minutes. There are countless articles in the professional literature today that describe the associations found between the functional muscle and skeletal orthognathic, which is a word for bone patterns associated with occlusal patterns of function. There are countless articles on this that describe the functional muscle and skeletal orthognathic alteration or dysfunction. And again, this particular research article lists, you know, up to 2020, many of those articles. And so it's a wonderful research venue to go to. Now I want to talk, I'll start off this webinar by talking about the visual neuro influence of the superior colliculus and the occipital lobes on the temporal lobes. And the superior colliculus, as I mentioned earlier, or the optic tectum, is a highly conserved midbrain nucleus of vertebrates that typically receive retinal input and directs the eyes and the body towards salient visual features. We operatively move with this midbrain nucleus. And so you can see by this illustration, this image will demonstrate its location. It's smack in the middle of the midbrain. Your basal ganglia lays above it, and your whole brainstem is feeding it and getting information from below. Our balance center behind of it, our visual cortex behind it, all this area is related to one organ, that eye. That eye supplements this entire activity of communication. You know, eyes are not living in a vacuum either. They're communicating with your feet. They communicate with your fingertips. They communicate with your autonomic nervous system's impact on your heart rate, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really important for us to remember that this midbrain region is surrounded by a mass of tissue, soft tissue. And that soft tissue is surrounded by, you know, this cortical activity surrounded by osseous structure. And the osseous structure is much more non-movable than the front around that eye. This is very movable areas, temporal, parietal. This is a region where there's an eyeball that has a number of bones moving on itself to regulate pressure, not only of the eye, but what's behind the eye called the midbrain. When you look at the structure itself, you can't separate this optic chiasm, this eyeball, from the midbrain. They're in the same region of your body. They know what's going on. They communicate both on a regular basis what is being presented, but they also present you with what you see and how you interpret what you see, and how you use that information is quickly deciphered by what kinds of gradients of pressure and resonance and frequency and harmony of shifting going on between the two sides of that brainstem. Your brain knows before your eyes know whether or not you're capable of moving from side to side. It maintains the balance of the head during walking or motor coordination in general through this visual complex interaction I just went over. The superior colliculus, along with this other part of the this region, which is your spinal thalamic tract, your substantia nigra, this red nucleus and this ocular motor nucleus for ocular motor extraocular function, all function in a very, very close proximity to itself in that midbrain region. This is a section through the superior colliculus showing the relationships to those regions and your ocular motor neurology. There is no such thing as an eye. An eye is part of the brain, and the brain is part of your vision. Whether you use your eye to see something or not, it is still a viable part of your brain for vestibular function. Your nucleus of where you are operatively belongs to that region. And I think it's important to discuss that a little bit. So when we talk about things that regulate both your body's function in terms of space that it's in, and things that you're on or sitting on or doing with your hands and legs, the cooperation of what's going on in that area with the amount of activity neurologically it's going to it, is important to understand that the what you see is a very small amount of information that's also being received at the same time from other areas of your body that has an impact on what you see, how you interpret it, and what you do with that information. It's a wonderful system for interplay. It's the highest area of our body for integration. In some species, including the fish and the birds, the optic tectum also is known as the optic lobe. It's one of the largest components of the brain in those species. The optic tectum is a major part of the midbrain and is the main visual processor of our brain function. So here's another illustration reminding us that you have all these nerves that are crossing over and all this chiasm work directly coming from your two globes of your eye that has an impact on your nucleus of ocular activity, the trochlear activity, and the abducens activity. And those nerves are directly communicating with this optic center. The cortex of our occipital lobes depend on it. Your balance center depends on that. It depends on a balance system that's shifting. That's the reason why they cross over in direct communication with the other side. The occipital lobes receive impulses from the back of the eye, the macula, through the optic nerves. These impulses are responsible for peripheral vision, night vision, color vision, and detailed vision. Visual data is then sent from the occipital lobe to the parietal lobes for interpretation of depth perception, and to the temporal lobes for processing of the image that you see. So when you see an image, your brain knows it's a cow versus a tree, because what you see can be sought and can be seen again. But for your interpretation of what you see, it has to get to the temporal lobe. And the temporal lobes have to resonate. They have to massage that information so that you can quickly identify what you're looking at, the bark of a tree or the back of a cow. And so that's why this information, as quickly as I'm going over it, when we get into the discussion of the ocular function as it relates to mandibular movement, there's a lot of processing going on as I speak today. My mandible is giving you information with things that I see out there called you. If I know you, I know your history a little bit. And I got to be able to do that without becoming confused when I see you. And that's all done through this midbrain region. Our ocular extrinsic muscles, our masticatory muscles, our dental pulp, and our periodontal ligaments are all linked to the cerebellum by this superior colliculus. You can't take dentistry out of the visual system, and you can't take the visual system out of the field of dentistry because of that sentence. I learned that 35 years ago. I had some wonderful mentors. They're inseparable. The core of these connections constitutes an important center for calculating position of your head, position of your mandible, position of your tongue, and the position of your eye movements. Due to the connections with the vestibular nuclei, the ocular motor nuclei, and your cerebellums. They do not work by themselves. They only work with those two other counterparts. That's the only way they can function. Now, I wish we had more time. When we get in the mesencephalic nucleus of the trigeminal system, you're talking about the mandible. You're talking about teeth. You're talking about occlusion. And Dr. Carlson, I'm so glad you're here this afternoon. It's an honor to see you today. You're talking about Dr. James Carlson. These discussions around where the nucleus of our trigeminal system is and the mandibular operative activity as a result of that nucleus is also a very important thing to discuss briefly. It's one of the trigeminal nerve is one of the sensory nuclei of the trigeminal, system. Cranial nerve number 5 is located in the brainstem. It is also located in the brainstem. It receives proprioceptive sensory information from the muscles of the mastication and other muscles of the head and neck. You can't separate head and neck from mastication. And you can't separate mastication from the head and the neck. So when you look at this illustration and you see this mesencephalic nucleus and the sensory nucleus, V1, V2, V3, the trigeminal ganglion, you have to think colliculus. You have to think breathing. And you have to think thought. You have to think communication with the body. And that spinal nucleus is a serious center for ocular motor function of both the visual system and the system that you have called teeth. The mesencephalic nucleus of the trigeminal system receives proprioceptive information from the eye muscles. You know, cranial nerve 3, all extraocular muscles except for lateral recti and superior oblique. Cranial number 4, lateral rectus, and cranial number 6, superior oblique. These are muscles that are postural muscles. The eye muscles provide information about the head in space, and in combination with the mandible position, please underline that. Provide for the whole body balance through a reciprocal connection between the vestibular nuclei. It's a wonderful article. I encourage you to read it. Eye muscles and its function on the orbit and the oral cavities. Quick little review. The eyeball and the ocular motor system are located in the orbital cavity that is a deep bone cavity, formed by the convergence of the process of the maxilla, the maxillary, the zygomatic, and the palatine bones in the lower part, by the convergence of the frontal and the sphenoid bones superiorly, from the lacrimal, ethmoid, and minimally maxillary and sphenoid bones medially, and from the zygomatic and the sphenoid bones laterally. It's a lot of words. So I asked Jen, let's put it up here. Let's look at it. So here's what she did. You got a frontal bone. And I know a lot of you know this, but let's just not take it for granted that you know it. This middle needs these spaces to stay in their right position. And when these little spaces start to be compressed, we're going to get into that, things happen with the neurological system. So these bones converge around an optic center, the center of this orbit. On one side, you've got an ethmoid, you've got a foramen of the ethmoid, you got an orbital plate of the ethmoid. You have a little lacrimal bone. You have a bone that I absolutely adore called the palatine bone. This little bone regulates autonomics right there. This maxilla is a huge bone. I'm going to show you a better picture of it in a few minutes. This is your zygoma. This is the orbital surface of the zygoma. The zygoma owns the eyeball. This is your sphenoid. The sphenoid owns pressure. Each one of those bones could tell you a story. Each one of them know their counterparts. Each one of them has muscle attaching to them, including extraocular muscle. And each one of these bones are working in an orbital way for trifecta activity: transverse, sagittal, oblique, and frontal type activity. Those bones move. They have to move. When you swell up, they swell up. When you get in a plane, they know you're in a plane at 30,000 feet. They know when you hit the ground. They have a little center called this common tendinous ring of Zen. And one muscle called the superior oblique attaches to the cranium above, and another muscle called the inferior oblique attaches to the bone, the cranium, from below. All the other muscles attach to themselves through a ring of tension at the back of that eyeball. So that eyeball does one thing in life. It shifts your body. It shifts itself. It turns the body, and it turns itself. And I could get into a lot of discussion about vision. But the most important thing to recognize as movement specialists, who do you think you are when you roll around a hip? You don't roll around a hip without your orbit and your globe allowing it. That's called perception. So when you look at this annulus of Zen, that fibrous ring in the back of your eye, it's surrounding an optic canal. It surrounds, therefore, your brain. That optic canal has, as you're going to see in a few minutes, brain tissue that's directly connected to the midbrain. And the superior orbital fissure at the orbital apex gives origin to the four major muscles of your body's ability to shift and rotate: the medial, inferior, lateral, and superior ocular muscle. The superior oblique is one of my favorite eye muscles. It is an extraocular muscle that comes from the back of the orbit. It travels through a small pulley, the trochlea, in the orbit near the nose, and then attaches to the top of the eye. It rotates your body. It rotates the eye inward around a long axis of the eye, front to back. I would encourage you, I don't want to leave this slide until you underline, it comes from the back of your orbit. It attaches to the bone of your cranium. The superior oblique is one of the ocular eye muscles that has the greatest impact on your cranium because of that attachment. When the eye on one side looks towards the nose, as the other eye is looking away from the nose and the face turn to the eye that is rotating the eye inward. So when you look at this muscle from above, you'll see it attached to the globe, but you have to understand that superior oblique is extremely important for rotation and shifting of the eye. So its attachment directly to the cranium has a major impact on temporal function. Temporal function regulates mandibular function. Mandibular function regulates trochleas of the eye. And we'll get into some of the clinical reasoning behind that research to support what I just said towards the end of this webinar. The inferior oblique is responsible for extorsion, elevation, and abduction. It attaches to the intermedial orbital floor, which is called the maxilla, to the lateral eye. Your palates know what the eye does. Your eyes know where the palate's at. A high palate will have an influence on that eye, just like a low palate will. And I'm reminded, Jen, today, we know once we put things in print, we can't go back and undo it. This has not been put in print by me. This is in print if you look for it. In a lot of places. This is not new information. It's been out there for years. But the dental community and the optometry and ophthalmologic community don't usually see eye to eye on this because it's not often looked at. It's not addressed in schools. So when you look at this structure, I see teeth, I see feet. I see autonomics. I see periphery. I see propulsion. I see push. I see shift. I see perception, which is really important for you all to understand. Here's what I really see. I see what I can't see. The only person that can see all those areas and have discriminatory thought process unique to that individual is the one that actually owns that ring of Zen, the sphenoid. And the only person that can predict that would be how you use your extraocular eye muscles with the other extra osseous muscles you have in your body. And how do they correlate with each other? What information is being received and patterned by it? This is an orthopedic discussion. I'm seeing a hip socket. I'm seeing a shoulder socket. I'm not trying to be outlandish. And if you understand what really is going on with that visual cortex because of that, the intraocular system, the real McCoy in terms of depth perception, finite, discrimination, the ability to take a retina and decipher how close you are to something to see it clearly, has to interplay with the body that's going to move you towards it or from it. We're going to talk about forward head position in a few minutes, but the fastest growing problem in this country is called myopia because people want to be closer. That's what I see. Recruitment of these two muscles, the superior and inferior oblique, when the neck is not in alignment with the shoulders or hips, leads to possible eye dysfunction, such as poor ocular convergence. Convergence is a major issue for humans on this planet. We're either overconverged or underconverged. Our palates are too close or they're not too close. Our throats are too tight or they're not too tight. Our shoulders are too close or they're not too close. Our hips are too tight or they're not too tight. Our binocular vision is overconverged or underconverged. We have two halves that are being pulled together by a visual cortex, a midbrain that wants you to be tight. Especially when that ocular function of rhythm from shifting from side to side is not possible. So I just want to make sure that what we're going over has a, you're here for a reason. Why? Because these muscles move and adjust our craniums. Your head is sitting on a spine, and the spine can only support the head. But what regulates the activity on that supportive system is a visual vestibular cortex. It's colliculi, it's pons, it's midbrain, it's your two eyes. And that lateral pterygoid, the same thing that lateral pterygoid does to your mandible is the same thing that your two oblique or two inferior and superior oblique muscles do to your orbits. So these two muscles move and adjust the cranium or orbit, like the lateral pterygoid muscles of the mandible move and adjust the cranium or the sphenoid bone. We have four webinars, and all four webinars are around that sentence. And it's important for you to recognize that you can't separate a pterygoid from an oblique muscle of the eye. You would literally twist the head in directions that it could not tolerate. The lateral pterygoid muscle of the orbit and the superior inferior oblique muscles and vice versa are unique. So therefore the lateral pterygoid muscles of the orbit are the superior and inferior oblique muscles and vice versa. You don't have pterygoid muscles in your eye, but theoretically you do. They're called superior and inferior obliques. And you don't have superior and inferior obliques in your mandible, but theoretically you do. They're called they're called lateral pterygoids. So basically you have these muscles that control rotary function when you're laterally moving. We have a head in the lateral pterygoid called the superior head, only be complemented by an inferior head. And those superior inferior fibers of the head, of the mandible, and the eye itself are in regulation patterning contexts. They cortically function. The brain understands that rotary and lateral trusive function. Mandibles move from side to side. Eyeballs move from side to side. Additionally, I've seen these correlations of temporal mandibular dysfunction and oral occlusal dysfunction in people who have been labeled or diagnosed with eye dysfunction. Esotropia, exotropia, hypertropia, hypotropia, and the big one, strabismus. Looking at an object with both eyes or chewing with both sides of the mandible is difficult, challenging, and many times impossible when these conditions coexist. The most difficult patient I ever work with is a strabismus patient, because a strabismus patient has a difficult time managing their mandibles. These people are often clenchers. They're constantly looking for resolution. Where do I belong? What am I in? What do I need to do to feel better? With their vision, their eyesight, and with their ability to hold themselves stable when they look with their eye at an object or focus. Because of their courses of action, the superior and inferior oblique muscles are the only muscles that can depress or elevate the eye or assist in lifting or lowering the front of the skull, thus having some influence on the temporal bone or temporal orbit and the mandibular head or globe, respectively, when the eyes move in adduction or towards the nose. Upgaze, or turning the eye upward, occurs when the head goes forward, as horizontal vision is maintained. It is primarily the work of the superior rectus muscle, with some contribution by the inferior oblique muscle, that moves the maxilla up and forward. as the mandible is moved forward and down by the temporal mandibular joints, resulting in an open bite somewhere in the process and path of least mandibular and occlusal resistance. Open bites and mouths reflect this dysfunctional process with extraocular, I'll call it synapsing or concomitant activity. Down gazing or turning the eye downward is primarily the work of the inferior rectus with some contribution by the superior oblique. The anterior temporalis muscle assists this process and along with the overuse of the inferior rectus may contribute to a posterior open bite over time. I see lots of posterior open bites in the clinic on people who are down gazers. So that was just a quick little overview of some of the relationship with the when it comes to the mandible and the extraocular musculature. But now I'm going to talk a little bit about fusion, binocular fusion and mandibular fusion. And binocular fusion, by using that word, binocular, two eyes that work together. It refers to the process or set of processes through which information from the two eyes is combined to yield a single visual system, single visual meaning, rather than a double vision meaning or what we would call diplopia. By 4 months of age, a child's eyes should be working together and binocular vision or depth perception should continue to develop up to 12 months. Our fusional convergence, our stereopsis, and our visual acuity matures with cortical neurons that are also influenced by our hearing, our motor expression, and chewing muscles of our face and the mandible. And any pathogenesis of our occlusal and speech function during that time will have a direct impact on our ability to use our two eyes together. And there's I've got research coming up that'll support that. Each eye is presented separately with a stimulus pattern that can be fused into a single image while the other eye is focusing on that same image. The eye seeing the steady pattern is termed the reference eye or the dominant referenced eye. Stability of the visual binocular system develops between the ages of 4 to 6. This is referred to the eye as a dominant eye or an ocular dominance. The dominant or referencing eye usually looks directly at an object, while the other eye, as a referent eye, turns sufficiently to produce the convergence necessary for single binocular vision. Poor focusing with both eyes working together often leads to pattern lateral shifting of the mandible. When mandibles do not have the capability of shifting from side to side, more than likely you're working with individuals that have a difficult time focusing with one side of their body as well as they can focus with the other side. It's not just a mandibular issue. It's a focal point issue. Poor focusing with both eyes working together often leads to patterned lateral shifting of the mandible, usually to the left on the body that usually stays oriented over on the right. To the right. Let's talk a little bit about mandibular fusion. By the way, for anybody in the Posture Restoration Institute, that last slide should have meant a lot. Closure of the mandibular sutures occurs by the age of 7 to 8 months. Our fusional convergence of our mandible, our stereopsis, our fusional convergence, our stereopsis, and our visual acuity matures with cortical neurons. They're also influenced by our hearing, our motor expression, our chewing muscles of our face, and our mandible. You have two of them. And any other pathogenesis of our occlusal and speech function. Fusion is a reflection of everything I listed in that paragraph. When you say the word fusion, we were given this gift to understand midlines. we were given the gift to look at something and say, there's the center. We were given the gift to sit on the middle of a chair. We were given the gift to understand our tailbone because of where we're at with respect to each side of it. Our greatest area of fusion is centered around this thing called the nose. It divides our face. It gives us room for thought, left side, right side. It allows the tongue to do its thing. But when the tongue becomes your midline, your ability to figure out which side is the eye on, the right side or left side of the nose, becomes kind of difficult. Or which side should my mandible stay over to, becomes kind of difficult. Malalignment of the neck and the head during the early years of postural development may lead into asymmetrical positioned temporal bones that contribute to mandibular pattern, mandibular occlusion interferences with the maxillary teeth. So you'll see at certain ages, the temporal bones steering mandibular activity. And in this webinar, you should be mindful that that steering is not from the temporal bones. The neurological steering is from your ocular system, your visual vestibular cortex, saying that this is where we think your eyes belong on each side of that nose. This is where you need to put your tongue. This is how you should sit on your tailbone. This is where your sacrum belongs. This is how your sternum should be positioned. Forces are not generated because one tooth is missing or some ramus on one side, one of them, is shorter or longer than the other. The ramuses are products, that growth is a product of how you neurologically function with your colliculi. These forces placed on the two sides of the mandible may result in one side becoming shorter or longer than the other side, and one side becoming more neurophysiologically sensed than the other side. And now your brain is tied into that function. And this length discrepancy is truly not an orthopedic length discrepancy. It's the if there is a length discrepancy, it's the result of how you use that bone, that function. The length discrepancy in the occlusal contact or the interference lack of balance may contribute to the loss of a parallel relationship between the optical axis of your two eyes. The real issue is, where's your optical axis? The lack of parallel tension and function at the temporal mandibular joints often results in some form of diplopia, double vision, eye strain, binocular rivalry, astigmatism, overconvergence, or peripheral visual neglect. Marcella, 2016. Consider reading it. So when you look at the mandibular ocular versus the ocular mandibular dysfunctional influences on posture, you have to consider some of these highlights. Let's start with the mandibular ocular considerations. There are many studies that correlate the different visual defects or dysfunction to specific malocclusions, many of them. Baldini has taken a deep dive into the ocular dysfunction and its relationship to temporal and mandibular dysfunction. Here's an article written by a group of researchers that says there's a relationship between ocular dysfunction and temporal and mandibular activity. Here are some of the other most notable associations, that notable research that associate that same type of activity. And I've listed those for you. And I told Jen I wouldn't read them, but they all kind of follow the same suit. Ocular convergence defects are associated with functional mandibular lateral deviations in children. There's research articles in your handout on motility disorders and midline deviation and fusional vergence defects, especially with the class twos. Myopia, hyperopia, and astigmatism, correlations that you should all be aware of that coexist with occlusal issues, mandibular issues, cervical issues. The presence of unphysiological gait due to ocular convergence. There's another study that talks about higher prevalent activities of ocular convergence as it relates to TMD. Binocular function as it relates to mandibular dysfunction. By now, you can see that every time I use the word mandible in this webinar, I'm underlying it so you don't miss it. Alteration of dental occlusion or wearing a mandibular orthopedic repositioning appliance can usually and usually does induce fluctuations in visual focusing ability. Our ability to focus depends on our ability to understand mandibular activity from side to side. If our mandible is stuck in a position, our ability to focus is extremely challenging, to say the least. Palatal expanders and their stress placed on the sutures of the cranial base through a finite analysis of data for children and adults of research done by a number of researchers have shown that the greatest stress is placed on the sphenoid bone, and that is in continuity with the mandible. All these articles are telling you, when you start to expand a palate, you are doing much more than expanding a palate. It doesn't mean that you're doing something negative or positive. You should be mindful that when palates expand artificially, the systems associated with that expansion also know it. So the take-home message is, when the maxilla and palatine bones move closer together or further apart, the teeth and eye function will. That's not even a possibility of not being true. Will change. I didn't say how much. I didn't say where. But any healthcare professional that's putting anything in a mouth or any eye doctor that's putting anything on top of the eyes to help with fusion or focus will change arches, will change dimension of cavities in the cranium. The pterygoid processes, both pterygoid processes and the superior orbital fissures, therefore, and the optic foramen, therefore, are most affected by the torque placed on this site. There's two thises there. Didn't mean to have two thises there. Through palatal expansion. Palate expansion is a physiological state of activity. It should not be an artificial state of activity. I've worked with people who have expanded their own palates by making sure that their visualization process, a peripheralization, has been restored. Widening the world they're in, getting them to understand the importance of array of flow, ambient, peripheral, proprioceptive, sensory awareness, so that this midbrain has the ability to register activity at extremes on both ends of the nose. That's what it's all about. In addition, any stress associated with asymmetry of the head or mandible could lead to alteration of the ocular motor function through direct mechanical changes of the position of the optical hole that attaches to that Zen tendon I talked to you about earlier, that ring that is common in origin of five ocular motor muscles, or through an indirect mechanical compression of one or more ocular motor nerves, all resulting in pathogenesis of their innervated responsibilities. So when you look at this lacrimal region, this trochlear region, this frontal region, and you look at inside that cavity, that deep cavity of the orbit, way back there, you have this area where you have a sphenoid bone, other bones that we went over, but let's look what's in that region. An inducens nerve, an ocular motor nerve, upper and lower, a nasal ciliary nerve, a frontal nerve, a trochlear nerve, a lacrimal nerve. This inferior orbital fissure is precious. So is the superior orbital fissure. You don't want those two come together. You want them to stay apart. Another view, a lateral view of the mandibular anatomy, from the outside looking, there's your orbital surface. This surface is a floor, just like the floor of your mouth. This is a part of your body that was made to push, lift, pull, compress, expand. There's that infraorbital groove. There's your ethmoid, lacrimal bone again, and those are those fissures. The alveolar canal is there. Teeth support it. Mandible. Just mandible. Lateral view of the mandible, Jen, it should say maxilla. So mandible activity depends on this lateral activity. Depends on this maxillary, Jen, activity. I'm sorry about that. Inside this orbit that I just showed you with all that activity where all those nerves are coming from, you have this fissure again in the optic foramen. And you want this to constantly be moving and bathing in tissue and allow that structure to stay like it should in its circular dimensions that it was placed in. I believe they have this in their manual, don't they? Yep. And then in that center of that depth of that cavernous region, you have what we call the Zen, the ring of Zen. You have rectus lateralis, superior, medialis, and inferior. They all attach right there. That's a lot of activity going on in that region, right around the orbital fissures, superior and inferior. Again, this area was meant to expand and compress. You were given that beautiful region of osseous come together activity for one word, expansion. And if you have a palate or a mouth that is not moving, the real palate and mouth that is not moving is that orbit. That's called midbrain, right behind it. So, is vision important? I think so. Is vision important for individuals who have an open bite or malocclusions? I think so. And I think it's an imbalance that makes that answer a reality. When you have an imbalance of the mandibular position, which causes different positions of the head, your cranium, and therefore the neck, your extraocular muscles know it. It leads to impairment of forward locomotor effort, and it leads to approaching visual processing with extreme difficulty. And I encourage you to underline the word approach. Things become blurry in life. Compensation for this disturbance of the postural visual integrated equilibration usually requires eye and foot hand dominance use and time of use. In addition to the bilateral cortical representation generated activity that reflects the associated dissymmetrical patterns of behavior and associated confusion associated with visualization of what's going by you. This article's title says, Dental Malocclusion in Mixed Dentition Children and Its Relationship to the Podal System and Gait Parameters. So vision is not forgotten in a lot of this research. Now let's talk a little bit about the ocular mandibular considerations. Cyclotorsion of the eye, secondary to angled horizontal gaze or cervical pattern positioning influence on temporal bone counteractive stabilization of the visual occipital process, can influence the trigeminal freedom and activity and the associated mandible muscles, length, tension ratios. The muscles of the eyes, upper eyelids, and forehead, the ophthalmic branch of the trigeminal nerve, the muscles of the cheeks, the nose, the lower eyelids, and upper lips, which is your maxillary branch of the trigeminal nerve, and the muscles of the mandible and the lower lip that help us bite, chew, and swallow, which is the mandibular branch of the trigeminal nerve, all influence the balance and posture of our craniums. The tendons fascia that surrounds the eyeballs and corresponds with the muscle and fascia that on the outside of the eyeball. The thickness of the temporalis muscle and the tension of the epicranial muscle varies from one side of the face to the other side of the face in myopic patients. This fascia is part of, this web is part of the design of the symmetry of our face or lack of. Research will tell you that one side of your face is thicker. One side of your face is thinner. Muscle is more tense or less tense, more thick. Fascia is less thick. Fascia is more stringent. Read the article. Statistically significant higher prevalence was found in subjects showing myopia in class 2 division 1 malocclusions, while no other significant difference was found for prevalence in other classes. Imbalanced mandibles means imbalanced fascia, imbalanced orbits, imbalanced globes, imbalanced focus, and need to really work hard to figure out which eye will you focus the other eye on. So we just had this illustration drawn by our illustrator in this institute, and she did a wonderful job. And you can see by looking at the skull, the asymmetries of it. You can see the temporal bones more visible on the right side, less on the left. You'll see a zygoma that's more prominent. You'll see a deep eyeball over here, but a round eyeball. And you'll see more possibly an open superior inferior orbital fissure, where over here it's in a different position. You don't even see the floor of the orbit. It's deeper, it's compressed. The whole head is shifted to the left, shifted to over to the left if you look at it from the top down. You may not see what we try to draw, but I think this little boy will tell you what we're trying to draw. It's the same face. That's a myopic individual. A young guy that's trying to grow up using one eye as a reference. His chin's already deflected. His nose is skewed. His ears are talking to you. His right eye is his soul. His head and his cranium is starting to shift on you at this age. And he was seen by a dentist for help. Nothing against the dentist. But there's no activity going on between a group of interdisciplinary people looking at this young man. And I think we put it in your manual where you have one, it's all on the same page, right, Jan? You just look at the top illustration and look down at this young man's photo. These trigeminal issues, these trigeminal muscles, and their afferents may have an influence on body posture and the association with their visual processes. Kuchia. The structure encircled by the fibrous ring includes the optic nerve, the ophthalmic artery, and four smaller nerves, abducens, nasal ciliary, and two branches of the oculomotor nerve. They can be compressed by a cyclotorsion of the eye or torsion of the orbit, secondary to vestibular or perceptual issues. What they see is what they generate. As a result of poor eye fusion and increased dominant eye activity that influence the visual planes they're working in life. More equally important, the occlusal plane of function. A plane passing through the point of sight is called the visual plane. The plane has a visual axis of the two eyes. The plane has the visual axis of the two eyes lie in a binocular vision that hopefully is not challenged by the horizontal environmental planes. So here's a picture of an illustration of a two eyes that lie in a plane. They should lie in a normal vector sagittal plane for normal sagittal activity without skewing the head from left to right. Occlusal plane canting is one characteristic that must be evaluated in any assessment of smile aesthetics. It describes the vertical position of the teeth when the left and right sides are different. This is defined as an upward or downward rotation in the frontal plane of one side over the other. And so when you take a head and you take the mandible off for a moment and you look at the eyeball and you look at the zygoma and you look at all the bone underneath of it, if you tip that system to one side, which this illustration shows you, the neurology associated with the pattern that that cant or that tip is, tipping is in corresponds with all the other respiratory and other neurological activity of the entire system. And over time, you develop these things called cants, C-A-N-T. We're going to talk about them. Better yet, you develop these occlusal, otic, and optic planes of dysfunction, all related to each other. And over time, that imbalance force, Dr. Carlson, starts to look like something like this. Those vectors of occlusion start to change. They're no longer, they're not perpendicular anymore. They're transmitted unevenly. That's not, and then look at the visual system. I don't know, Jim, if you did this intentionally or not. Brilliant. And inside that eye, inside that mouth, there's cyclotorsion going on. Palates are being twisted. Cheeks are being pushed out. People suck their cheeks in. They push their tongues between teeth. There's not enough room for the base of the tongue. And now the tongue becomes the issue. When in reality, the real issue is the superior and inferior vestibular vestibules that are being overly compressed, reducing neurological system of feedback and feed input. These are precious, precious regions for midbrain. These planes, Dr. Carlson, this orbital plane, this otic plane, this plane of occlusion, who in their right mind think that they don't exist for a reason? They are all knowledgeable on what their counterparts are doing through the midbrain. The front of the face, the thing you look at, is not telling you a thing like what's going on in the center of that face. And the function of that human is driven by what's going on there, not what's going on here. Stress is associated with lateral bending in the transverse plane of the cranium, result in compression on the labial tissue of the mouth, secondary to visual constraint, such as constraint related to the tropias we talked about, phorias, vergences, or strabismus dissymmetry, dissymmetrical fusion. All these visual constraints can possibly contribute to irregular formation of the lingual aspect of the mandibular symphysis. This is the mandibular symphysis. And there are forces placed on these two mandibles, these two ramuses. And those forces are not coming from a temporal bone. Those forces are coming from the influences on that temporal bone. They're coming from vertical bending in the coronal plane that can result in compression in the coronal plane, resulting in alveolar activity, secondary to visual constraints, such as constraint related to forward head position. I don't really think many of us really understand the significance and the impact of dissymmetry produced by forward head postures. I really don't believe the world understands that. Forward head postures is this: amblyopia, myopia, hyperopia, and hemicortical function or dysfunction. That's forward head posture. Your heads cannot go forward in a symmetrical plane. Impossible. They go forward in a dissymmetrical planes. They can't go forward on both sides the same way. They go forward on one side. And when they go forward on one side, you will have eye vergence, cyclotorsion, astigmatism, myopic issues. That's what the research is telling you. All of these can also contribute to irregular formation of the mandibular symphysis base. Mandibles don't look balanced anymore. You look at those mandibles and they've got a little protuberance on one side. Teeth come up in the middle. Arches push into the middle, usually on one side more than the other. On the same people who have a 0.75 minus on one eye and a 0.25 on the other eye. And don't take me literally on that. The amblyopic eye is a quick manifestation of midbrain constraint. Myopia is the fastest growing refractive error of the human visual system. It is expected that by the year 2030, almost half of the world's population will have myopia. Myopia is often associated with people who have forward head postures. One research study reported that the anterior displacement of the head or forward head posture causes a loss of field vision, which is integrated with an increase in lordosis of the neck, and therefore the loss of posterior vertical dimension of the oral cavity. I honestly want to hug this researcher. And it was written in 1954. We haven't come very far, Dr. Carlson. We haven't come very far. And when I see pictures like this, from this thought process, teeth come up, angles of spee are distorted, imbalances of ramuses, temporal bones that are pushing discs forward or back, open and closed bites, et cetera, et cetera. The first thing I think about is that. You don't have a mandible. You have an ocular oral system. You don't own a mandible. Your visual system owns it. You don't own your eyes. Your teeth own it. And if those two systems are not balanced for harmonic activity from side to side as we started this webinar, neither one of them are really owned by anybody because it's called state of confusion. So I'm only trying really hard to help you understand what the research is telling us. Those forces, Dr. Carlson, thank you again, are balanced along the plane of occlusion when the orthogonal alignment exists. We all should be thinking about planes of horizontal activity, whether it's at the feet, the teeth, the eyes, or the vestibular system. We should all be thinking about that. Those planes of occlusion are reference points for your midbrain. That's the first thing the midbrain's looking at, is that reference system. That's called vestibular. It's called inner ear. It's called people who have POTS and motion sickness, when things start to move and they can't regulate themselves because they're in a state of regulatory balanced confusion, which begins in the midbrain. So when you look at this picture, it's impossible to separate this and this bone from that orbit. It's impossible to do that. And I didn't write this. My friend, Dr. Carlson, wrote this. He said, this is optimally the mandibular teeth fit during function. You have to consider that that system, that visual system, that system, in order for it to have vertical mid-sagittal plane of activity, optimally, horizontal vectors have to be respected by the systems of vision, hearing, throat, and teeth. I think I said all that, Jen, so I'm gonna move on. Otherwise, what you see is the curvatures inside the cranium. And again, all these references you have, you see forces placed on the squama of occipital bone, and you see irregular alignment, things that are more open on one side and less open on the other. And again, you're looking at the base of the skull, and right here is the base of the skull, right here is a base of an orbit. And that's the kind of pressure that head's occiput going to the right is the same inside of the head that you saw on the illustration earlier that was then followed up by the photo of that young little man. These are called patterns. In our institute, we call that a right temporal mandibular pattern, cervical chain pattern. The visual and ocular neurodynamics, therefore, if not addressed, can unbalance forces that push our bases of our cranium up and down through mandibular counter compensatory regulation of the head and neck to keep us posturally secure. Any unbalanced force of occlusion will definitely have an impact on the visual system. It'll have an impact on how low or high you feel on that side, and how deep the room is, and how you need to focus in a compensatory way with what's in front of you. The adaptation of your body is one thing to the space around you, but the adaptation to the thing that's moving in front of you is another thing. Not being able to catch that thing because of poor binocular fusion or poor binocular fixation results in insecurity of the entire system. People trip, people lean, people list, people fall, people miscalculate. And that's what these slides are all about. We don't want malformation of the cranial mandibular joint complex. We want alignment. And those forces that you see in this illustration by Dr. Carlson, forces that go through the teeth are being created by forces that are perceived through the visual cortex. You can easily disrupt those forces by allowing that binocular system to resonate with a good set of parallel planes of activity. And that's what we do with optometry. We try to balance out the visual process so you can relax and see things more clearly. Unfortunately, we're doing that with individuals who are still in a chair, who still do not understand the 2 feet they have, who still don't understand the 2 sets of mandibular teeth that they have, who still don't understand planes of forces going through those sides of the body that I went over in this webinar. It's no one's fault. This young lady wishes she had a team of people, this is the same pattern, a team of people looking at her visual cortex as we do her beautiful aesthetic teeth. She's been in braces twice. She has one eye that doesn't even know that she's got another eye. Most dysfunctional ocular patients have a loss of posterior vertical dimension, either on one side or the other, or both. Vertical dimension is the length of the face determined by the distance of the separation of the mandibles. Mandibles need to stay apart. Temporal bones need to stay apart. Hips need to stay apart. Shoulders need to stay apart. Floors need to stay apart. If you don't stay apart, the loss of that dimension can result in bruxism, clenching, loss of posterior teeth, over-equilibration of posterior teeth, orthodontic treatment, including extraction of bicuspids, and guaranteed ocular dysfunction. The loss of vertical support for the mandible causes the mandibular condyles, or the TM joints, to move posterior superiorly, therefore compressing the joints themselves and the tissue in it, displacing discs, displacing the temporal bones back and up, and the occiput bone and cervical spine, displacing into that occipital bone and that cervical spine, all because of loss of vertical support. All TMJ problems, more than likely, encompass cranial and cervical neurological, muscular, and osseous functional dyssymmetry. I believe that like I exist. So for me to be able to treat someone effectively, you have to take in consideration that dyssymmetry and the regions that matter the most. Mid brain. The vagus nerve is often the primary nerve affected with cranial mandibular dysfunction. Patients usually have corresponding respiratory, heart, gut, and visual issues because the autonomic nervous system innervates the ciliary muscle, the focus muscle of your eye, of your world. So I have some recommendations that maybe you'll consider, maybe you won't, for ocular mandibular activity. And I'm going to let Jan explain this to you, how this works and how these two techniques work and where they're at and how they were written up.
Sure. So these two techniques are with the handouts that are on our webinars page. But the first technique, there's two of them. The first one is peripheral visual alternation and standing. And you'll see the four pictures here that are on the technique. You can see them a little bit bigger and a little bit better on this PowerPoint slide. But Anne, who is demonstrating this technique here, she's just standing, feet shoulder width apart, hands relaxed at her side. And she just wants to find freeway space with her teeth. So she's going to separate her teeth, put her tongue between her mouth, and just find freeway space, bring her tongue back in. And then what we ask Anne to do while she continues to breathe in through her nose and out through her mouth is the instructions will ask her to look or move her eyes to the left and her mandible to the right gently and slowly without use of the tongue. Don't want to look, you know, don't strain when you look with your eyes to the left, and don't move your mandible too far laterally as you might use your tongue. To help you do it. So she's looking to the left and she has her mandible moved to the right, and then she's going to move the right hand and arm forward as she moves the left hand and arm backward. The next step can be kind of confusing, but without looking to the right, by turning her eyes to the right, she's going to use her peripheral vision to see and just acknowledge and locate that she has a right hand and arm. So if you guys want to try this at home, you're going to look to the left and your right hand's going to be out in front of you. And you're not going to be able to tell like how many fingers you're holding up by any means, but you should at least just know, even though you're looking to the left, that your right hand is out in front of you and you should be able to see it. But again, you're not going to be able to someone, you know, if you were holding three fingers up, your eyes wouldn't be able to recognize that you have three fingers. And you're just going to hold this peripheral awareness for position for 3 to 4 breaths. Again, in through your nose, nice out through your mouth.
Good, 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 relaxed breathing. Not over breathing. Slow, effortless breathing.
After 3 to 4 breaths, you return your eyes back to the midline of your forward focus. Find your freeway space again with the use of your tongue and gently pull it back into your mouth. And then you're going to reverse it. You're going to look to the right with both eyes and continue to breathe as before. While keeping your eyes turned to the right, move your mandible to the left without using your tongue. Move your left hand and arm forward as you move your right hand and arm backwards. Without looking to the left, by turning your eyes to the left, use your peripheral vision to see and locate the left hand and arm. So now your eyes are looking to the right, but you again just want to locate, be aware of, know that your left hand and arm are in front of you.
And again, thank you, Janet.
Breathe,
yeah. And again, those people who really, I know there's some optometrists in the room or will be in the future. This is a wonderful technique to use prior to, you know, looking at standing refraction or getting someone to really, really understand how to confuse confusion, confuse patterns. So your ocular mandibular patterning will be confused with this technique, which is ideal. You want to reset with the floor underneath you. Reweight, redistribute, realign, recompress, redecompress. This technique follows an earlier webinar technique, Jan, where we focused on the mandible. We're focusing on the ocular visual influences on the mandible here. So it's, these four webinars are in a progressive series to make this more less challenging, more positively encountered. Might be the most difficult thing you have a patient do, especially if they don't know how to move a mandible with arms. So Jen, thank you so much.
A couple questions about this technique. One person said, should you do this technique or both of these techniques with your glasses on or off?
Absolutely, with glasses on.
Yeah, if they wear glasses.
Absolutely, glasses. Absolutely. Now, when you get done, you may notice that the world seems a little brighter. Colors change. Things seem a little wider. And if you see like, and then if you try to read and you can't read as clear, it's a great opportunity to say, hey, go to your optometrist and have your eyes rechecked. The people in the room that know me that are optometrists will know that I'm a very big fan of standing refractions. I'm a very big fan of Dr. Carlson of standing occlusion. Now, when you're done, stand up. Let's see if that interference has changed from the position you were in when you were in the chair. I'm not a fan of any discipline working with people called patients and clients with a forward head. It just makes me crazy. We don't want forward heads. So any type of work you do where the head is right between the two shoulders in an upright state is how God made us. Let's talk about the other one, Jen.
Just a couple more questions while we're on this technique. The question came on into why is this technique done barefoot, same as the one in the last webinar, both state barefoot on or with shoes. So the second sentence says, to sense your toes and inside arches on the ground or floor, use shoes if necessary.
The purpose of this floor being, raw is for proprioceptual perceptual awareness. Perception. You cover it up when you put a splint in your mouth. You cover it up when you put a shoe on your foot. You cover it up, especially if you put blinders on your eyes, called contacts or glasses. But we have to start somewhere with a system that's already patterned. So the minute you take your shoes off, your visual cortex knows it. It's freed up. You have another sensory element going to your inferior and superior colliculus. Your red nucleus is saying, wow, my eyes can relax. you have eye strain, you want to take your shoes off for this technique. There's only a certain amount of time I have in this webinar, but that was an excellent question whoever asked it. There's a reason for those shoes to be off. There's not a reason to put the shoes, you know, take the shoes off for the next technique, because the word forward is in that title. You've got to learn how to move with a heel striking the floor, so your posterior molars can support the orbital floor the globe is sitting on, to reduce the tension on the ring of Zen, to keep flow going to the ocular motor neurology, to allow rotation to go in counter directions that you're not familiar with, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So let's talk about it, Jen.
Okay, sorry. There was the last question, but this carries over to the next one, the tongue position. The question was, so tongue position is on the roof of the mouth. So the instructions say to put the tongue, slide your tongue through your front teeth, and then gently pull it back into your mouth, keeping the freeway space.
Yeah.
Keeping this freeway space and your tongue relaxed. So after you pull your tongue back into your mouth, yeah, you just pull it back behind those upper front teeth, and it's relaxed right on that upper palate, just behind your upper front teeth. Pushing it into your teeth. You shouldn't be moving it to one side versus the other, which a lot of your patients, clients will try to do, because they're going to try to move their mandible with their tongue.
They like to use tongues for forward head position.
So yes, just relaxed after you create that freeway.
Good question.
Okay, the next technique is peripheral visual alternation in forward locomotion. So we're going to kind of build on the last technique, but now we're going to add in forward locomotion or moving forward. So again, start off the exact same way, relaxed. Like Ron said, you have shoes on in this one because we're moving forward. We need heel strike. We need to feel our arch. We need to be able to push off the big toe.
I'm going to say this right now, Jen. I'm sorry, but Bob,
you're fine. Girl.
I think you'll appreciate this. I hope you do. Many of your patients are walking around with amblyopic feet, strabismus shoes, hyperopia and trophia and tropias in their toes. I'm not trying to be funny. They're working hard with the configuration of their toes and the sense they have from their feet because they're not binocular. The rivalry is high. The twisting is generated by how they program themselves horizontally and vertically with the floor underneath them or not. And you got two, the mandible and the floor you stand on. So, anybody that has problems with overpronation or oversupination on one foot has to have a tropia, trophia, or extraocular dysfunction above. There's not even a question. It has to exist because you cannot move your body from side to side without vertical, visual, spatial compensation. That's what this webinar is all about. The mandible is trying to help regulate what you cannot put together between the eyes and the feet. Proper lateral shifting. So a shoe, hopefully, not a worn one, a fairly new one for some of these patients that have heel support, arch support, and toe awareness, so they can locomotor-wise themselves in a forward direction and let go of the steering that's done by a superior and an inferior oblique that's directly attached to bone. Just like in one of our webinar series said, the lateral pterygoids are. And when lateral pterygoids and these extraocular muscles become postural stabilizers of your body on a floor, you don't need feet. You're now labeled with paroxysmal issues like POTS issues, orthostatic syndromes. You're lost in space. So I just want to make sure I stopped her there saying, why not put an orthotic on in this state to help relieve eye strain?
And by orthotic, he meant shoes. Okay. Now, so in this technique, I'm going to start the exact same way, except with shoes on this time, arms relaxed, find the freeway space again with the tongue, and then pull your tongue back into your mouth, keeping that freeway space, continue to breathe in through your nose, out through your mouth. And then that first picture, it says, move your eyes to the left and your mandible to the right, gently and slowly without the use of your tongue. Again, don't move your mandible too far laterally. Don't strain your eyes while looking to the left. And then you're going to move your right hand and arm and left foot and leg forward without looking to the right by turning your eyes to the right. Use your peripheral vision to see and locate the right hand and arm moving forward. So you start the exact same way. Now, as the left heel hits the floor, which is going to be that third picture, move your mandible slowly to the left without the use of your tongue and simultaneously move your eyes to the right. Yeah. Your left hand and arm and right foot and leg should be moving forward. Without looking to the left by turning your eyes to the left, use your peripheral vision to see or locate the left hand and arm moving forward. So that's going to be the fourth picture. Uh-huh. You're keeping the mandible to the left, eyes to the right, but you're being aware and you know that you have your left arm in front of you. Continue to move yourself forward by moving your mandible slowly to the right, gently again, as the right heel hits the floor, and simultaneously move your eyes to the left. Your right hand and arm and left foot and leg should be moving forward. There's a typo there, I'll fix that. Without looking to the right by turning your eyes to the right, use your peripheral vision to see and locate the right hand and arm moving forward. So again, picture number 5 shows the heel strike of that right side. And then kind of that mid position where your right hand is forward, your eyes are going left in that last picture, your mandible's going right. But even though your eyes are left, you're peripherally aware and know that your right hand is in front of you. And you know it's there with your peripheral vision. Continue to alternate in this manner as you move your body forward. And we actually have a video. I'll pull that up next year and you can watch and kind of do this technique.
And you should all know that Anne had to work at this for a while to write Jen.
Yes.
This is not something you're just going to have a patient do or you are going to do it. This is something you have to work at.
Yep.
And yeah. I encourage you to go back to the other webinars and look at some of the other techniques that we preceded this webinar with to make this easier. For years, I've been talking about coils, different horizontal planes of the body. And I'm not sure, you know, how much it helped anybody. But when I look at Anne walking like this in forward, we look more proper coil to coil, horizontal plane to horizontal plane, I'm fairly delighted because that system now is regulating that system. No one else is. Her system is being regulated by horizontal planes. And those horizontal planes are perceived. And they're working on themselves through the midbrain, the visual cortex, the occipital lobes, and your cerebellums. So it's an extremely pleasing thing to see interest in this by people like you who attend these webinars. And I encourage you to have others watch these 4 webinars series. Because the series on the mandible, because it doesn't mean you have to have TMJ issues. The temporal mandibular joint is just a site that says something's wrong with your midbrain, your cortex that's receiving visual, vestibular, spatial input. And that's what's really important for something like these force. That's what's really important for something like these two techniques.
Absolutely. Daniel asked Ron if you can elaborate a little bit more on what you mean by freeway space. I was going to respond to him, but I thought maybe someone listening to this.
Freeway space.
Same is, question.
Yeah, it's a good question. Freeway space to dentist out there, and I hope I'm going to reflect them. Freeway space to me is the space between your teeth, and you need space between your teeth for a lot of reasons. In the occlusal world, it's a place of rest. When you open your mouth and breathe and then relax, your mouth should stay apart. Now, there's reasons for your teeth to come together. Can't go over all the reasons. Chewing's one, jumping's one, pushing's one. You know, we need forces in our body to help regulate things that we desire to do. But when you stop that desired movement, you shouldn't have to put your teeth together, and you shouldn't have to lay your tongue between your teeth. You should have this 2 to 3 millimeters between the teeth of freeway space. Unfortunately, the world that I know today has more freeway space on one side of the mouth than the other. And so when we have those freeway spaces that are uneven, you're malaligned. Your alignment now is not because of the joints themselves, it's because of the neurology that you want, the neurology that you have that puts those joints in that position. That neurology is perceptually built. You've built that neurology over time. The more bilateral cortical function with your brain and the more bilateral cortical function you receive from both sides of your mouth, from both sides of the space around you, from both sides of the things underneath your feet, and from both hands, will keep that freeway space hopefully horizontal in what we call an occlusal plane that's desirable. When you close, when you stay open, you have the ability to make any decision you want to do with your body. When your teeth are closed and you don't have freeway space, you are a product of that imbalance because that's your start and stop regions. You are patterned. Your respiratory system is completely built off of freeway space. So I hope that helped answer that question. It's a point of rest.
Absolutely.
When your mouth is open.
Yes, good question. Another question here, Ron. Can you go over this figure that I have actually pulled up right now? I'm going to share it with them. What did you want people to recognize with the eyes and the arrows on the eyes in relationship to what the mandible is doing?
We have a limitation of time. I drew these eyes years ago, and I forgot I even drew them. Jen found them today somewhere. I don't know where she found them. But when eyes rotate in an orbit, or when an orbit rotates around the eyes, that's called torsion. When the eyes rotate, we refer to that as cyclotorsion. Some of our patients have degrees of cyclotorsion. You can see it. They're strabismus patients, or they're patients who have lazy eyes, amblyopic eyes. They can turn easily. They live on rotation. But for the most part, all of your eyes will turn. If your platform you're on moves one direction and you keep your body upright and your head is staying upright, and you stay parallel with the floor, you're going to have some degree of torsion. Torsion is a good thing. I have torsion in my mouth. I have torsion in my joints, my proximal joints. It's called torque. when your mandible has musculature that's trying to correct the when your body has musculature that's trying to assist with your torque perception, you want to untorque. You want to twist it the other direction to stay more stable. And when you do that, you can end up in a cyclotorsioned state, or you can stay in a state of rotation, because that's how you contend with the degree of malalignment. You produce a pattern. All patterns have some degree of rotation. And when that rotation gets into a direction state, the optometrist will catch it, or an ophthalmologist will catch it. A physical therapist may catch it when you look at the degrees of range of motion you have or do not have at a hip. You're in some state of limitation with rotation. So when you see the extraocular muscles steering a globe operatively, routinely, you're given a diagnosis. Remember, all optic function is neurology. All of it is. It's not orthopedics. So when that neurology is visible and you see this is an example, one example of many, on what two eyes that like to turn in towards the middle, like to overconverge, just one example, which I see a lot, that influences what's happening. If you look at the mandible, if this eye is turning in, then that mandible is also coming up and going with it, because it's on a cranium. That temporal bone, that maxillary orbit floor, and that temporal bone and the sphenoid and the zygoma are all going towards that nose. And along with it comes this ramus. And along with this one, if it does the same thing, comes that ramus. And then this upper part of the symphysis of the mandible push teeth up. And the bottom part pulls menti apart. And you have protruding little chins out here. And they open up their mouth and you can see their teeth are what? Coming up in the roof of their mouth. And the bites are very narrow. And the palate on top can follow, may not follow. But the bite on top probably is going to be in a state of asymmetry. It's probably going to have palates and palatine bones that reflect the compressive forces on the mid face, i.e. mid brain. So heads that have teeth that look like that, I can assure you the extraocular muscles are working very hard to try to get that cyclotorsion, or they completely drop off. They pick up an eye, they work on that eye, and that eye becomes their eye in that state of torsion. We call that astigmatisms. So yeah, I love looking at astigmatism patterns. I love it. Because when I see certain astigmatisms coupled with certain postures, I'm pretty sure when I open the mouth, I know what I'm going to see. So whoever asked the question, I'm only giving you one diagram of a commonly seen narrow palate. And someone who puts an expander on this individual, which I've seen countless times, and not operatively consider their throat, their vision, and their feet are generating a reversed neck. The heads are still going forward because you didn't address the other issues that correlate on what put that mouth in that position to begin with. Teeth don't just move there, Dr. Carlson. There are forces that are placed on those teeth, as you know, and you've so eloquently spent your lifetime helping people understand. interferences are not just tooth issues. Interferences exist below your feet, in your visual system, in your auditory system, and in your voice box. And it's fun. Unfortunately, we don't have schools of fun. We have schools of vacuums. And I'm not pointing my finger at any one of them. So I appreciate the question. I think we're going to call it there. I want to thank all of you for attending this webinar. And if you've attended the other three, I appreciate that. We're honored. We truly are honored. We work hard at these things because we know once we put it in print, it's there forever. And so we try really hard. Got a few misprints here and there, but overall, I think it went pretty well. But I want to thank you so much. Jen, is there anything else you want to say?
Very much. Yeah. Just want to remind you all that these webinars are continuing. Please save the date. This is the last of this series on the temporal mandibular webinars, but the next webinar will be on Friday, September 15th at 1 p.m. Central Time. And Ron will be discussing the Hruska adduction lift test and the Hruska abduction lift test during that webinar. So we really hope to see a good turnout for that webinar as well to learn a little bit more about those two questions. There are a couple other people that ask questions on here. I will keep the chat up here for just a few minutes and I will respond to you on the chat. But thank you again, everyone, for joining us on this webinar. And we hope you have a great day.
Thank you, everybody.